you all for being here. My name is Heba Abdel Fattah, and I'm a postdoctoral associate at Yale Institute of Sacred Music. Today, I have the pleasure of introducing our speakers and chairing this wonderful panel titled Death as Initiation, Funerals, Healing, and Expressive Culture. Unfortunately, John is not going to be with us here today, but we still have the pleasure and the luck to enjoy Kyle and Nia. So our first speaker today is Kyle Brooks. He is a native of Detroit, an assistant professor of homiletics, worship, and Black Church, and African Diaspora Studies at Methodist Theological School in Ohio. He completed his BA, MA, and MDiv degrees at Yale and earned his PhD in religion at Vanderbilt University. His upcoming book project develops a philosophical framework and a topology of the popular cultural tendency towards sacralizing Black male clerical leadership in historical and contemporary Black sociopolitical movements. His research interests include Black religious culture, public theology, religious dimensions of political culture, Black ritual and performance studies, and the intersection of religion, rhetoric, and communication. His work has been published in various print and digital venues, including the Journal of Feminist Studies in Religion, FIRE, the Multimedia Journal for Black Studies, and the Political Theology Network. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Kyle Brooks.
Thank you very much. Greetings. It's a homegoing, not a funeral. The sermonic selection and the transcendence of grief. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others who do not have hope. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. These words are a familiar refrain in the rhetoric of Black Protestant funeral services. The rhetoric hints at a practice of grief that contradicts expectation. It reconfigures the materials of loss into an opportunity for spiritual ascendance. In Black church traditions, the climactic preaching moment is frequently preceded by gospel musical selections that invite a shift in affective disposition and congregational receptivity to the anticipated word. Such selections, known as sermonic selections, often heighten the emotional sensitivity and prepare the hearts and minds of listeners for ready communication. In the preface to his text, Healing for the Soul, musicologist Braxton Shelley argues that gospel music accrues a spiritual force through the reiterative intensity of the musical cycle known as the vamp. He argues that the gospel vamp organizes expressive activity around a moment of transcendence. If the gospel vamp performs this work within the arc of a song, then how might the power of the vamp appear within the arc of the musically infused fabric of Black Pentecostal liturgy? Today, I want to think out loud about the function of this common Black church liturgical feature, the sermonic selection, as a facilitator of spiritual transcendence and collective healing. The liturgical construction of Black church funeral services provides an apparatus for holding together the contradictions of life and death as both a severance of natural life and a liberating return to the sacred cosmos. The rhetorical framing of funerals as homegoings and celebrations of life reflects a sense of that complexity. As well, funerals in the Black church traditions frequently serve as de facto reunions, as sites of remembrance and remembering of familial ties. In this way, the funeral rites become a site for healing reconnection. And when employed as an aspect of the funeral liturgy, the sermonic selection operates as a therapeutic musical assembly of language, gesture, and sonic material. So I'd like to frame this conversation of the sermonic selection in Black church funeral liturgies in three sort of primary moves. First, exploring the logic of vamp work in Shelley's text. Two, addressing Black church liturgical aesthetics and practices, specifically focusing on Black Pentecostal aesthetics. And finally, interpreting a gospel performance in light of these overlapping concerns. Vamp work. August 28th, 1963. You may recognize this as the date of the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. Popular cultural memory tends to characterize this event by the charismatic speech performance of Martin Luther King Jr. via his I Have a Dream speech. But my attention is drawn to its musical prelude, a solo by acclaimed gospel singer Mahalia Jackson. In an event devoid of women speakers, Jackson's musical voice becomes an instrument of atmospheric reorientation. Jackson's rendition of the classic African-American spiritual, "I've been buked and I've been scorned," is a lyrical testimony of tragic beauty, a narration of suffering, loneliness, death, and redemption. It is also a prime example of the ritual employment of music as a medium for accessing an emotional and spiritual register in which boundaries are relaxed and a collective ascent to transcendent power is produced. Writing to Jackson, King offers these words, quote, "When I got up to speak, I was already happy. I couldn't help preaching. Millions of people all over this country have said it was my greatest hour. I do not know, but if it was, you, more than any single person, helped to make it so." Unquote. King's words reflect a clear understanding of Jackson's artistry as a form of sacred incantation. Another way to put this is that Jackson's solo artistry participates in what musicologist Braxton Shelley calls the gospel imagination, belief, performance, and reception that creates conditions for turning spiritual power into a physical reality, a divine presence in human bodies. What becomes clear through a reading of Jackson's artistic labor is that this transcendent imagination is not bound exclusively to the formal spaces of Black church worship. If we read King's speech as an instance of sociopolitical sermonizing, an argument that is forwarded by communication scholars Carolyn Calloway Thomas and John Lewis Lucates, then we can interpret Jackson's song as nothing short of a sermonic selection. Jackson's solo initiates a palpable shift in the mood and energies of the massive crowd on the Washington Mall. As a CBS reporter said during the live telecast, "All the speeches in the world couldn't have brought the response that just came from the hymn she sang." The reporter, perhaps unknowingly, was speaking to the power of the gospel imagination. Shelley reminds us that gospel music performances embody a belief in what he calls thing power, the ability of sacred speech to incarnate the bond between visible and invisible realms. Such performances reveal the force of sacred words and offer audiences an experience of power. The impact of Jackson's performance within the scheme of the March on Washington strikes me as an expansion of the effect of the gospel vamp. I'm suggesting that the program of the march embodies a kind of liturgical structure, a repertoire of ideas and observances intended to be taken as a whole. And within that structure, Jackson's solo embodies a crescendo, the highest point of an increasing intensity. It is an example of the tonal and temporal shift called tuning up, what Shelley describes as the logic of the gospel imagination, a sonic device that signals and produces movement between the material and spiritual realms of Black Christian experience. Jackson's song transports the audience into a history of Black American experience, clarifying the everydayness of the genuine rebuke, scorn, and loneliness she and others knew so well. But it also carries the audience into a glimpse of another world made possible through belief, performance, and reception, a world of liberation and beloved community that Martin Luther King Jr. would articulate in his speech. I want to think of vamp work then as an extension of the internal logic of the musical vamp into the structure of liturgy. And whereas the vamp of a musical selection heightens and intensifies the moment of the song, vamp work suggests, for me, an intensification of the arc and movement of the liturgy writ large. Here, it'll be helpful to move into some reflection on the elements of liturgical structure as they manifest in Black church traditions, specifically focusing on Black Pentecostal contexts. First, a note. Within the body of literature on liturgical studies, there's long been a debate about the idea of non-liturgical churches, namely those whose theory and practice of public worship do not involve a fixed and prescribed ritual of language and action such as can be set down in a prayer book or a similar manual. And this has often been applied to American Protestant traditions such as the Baptists, the Methodists, Presbyterians, and so forth. Now, what's at stake for me is how this term has often privileged specific forms of documentation and standardization of practice and worship. By extension, it often eludes the serious consideration of the embodied logic and practice within traditions such as Black Pentecostalism. As Carl Holloway puts it, the experience of Black folk would constitute the church's sustainable and memorable text, and that an expressive spirituality would be its vehicle. In other words, she's speaking of a kind of way of enacting and embodying a sense of liturgical ritual. It is not about the written word on a page, but is about the kind of communal ethos that makes the thing a thing and gives it its power. Liturgist Jeffrey Wainwright makes the case that there are four elements to Christian worship. It is doxological, giving glory to God. It is anamnetic, presenting salvation history, in other words, the gospel. It's epicletic, the Holy Spirit is invoked in it. And finally, it is eschatological. It points towards a divine future. And within a Black Pentecostal liturgical landscape, what's at stake for me is how these elements are fulfilled. As fulfillment is related to the various functions that Black churches historically have played in honoring and engaging with the whole lives of African American people. In her text, Passed On, African American Mourning Stories, Carla F.C. Holloway draws specific attention to the significance of the 20th century Black church and its role in carving out space for the acknowledgement, healing, context, and closure of the lives of Black people. Holloway places emphasis on the role of the church in furnishing refined rituals of death and dying. And in this role, African American funeral rituals also exalted and amplified the social solidarity that accompanied the cultural experience of race. Now, while I don't have time to flesh out all the particulars of Black Pentecostal practices, I want to highlight some particular ideas that I think are salient for thinking about the unfolding of vamp work. So in his groundbreaking text, Black Pentecostal Breath, The Aesthetics of Liberation, Sean Crawley describes what he calls the choreographic, sonic, and visual aesthetic practices and sensual experiences of Black Pentecostalism. Namely, he speaks about breath as the necessary physiological and spiritual force that is the constitutive element of Black Pentecostal performative production. And this idea of breath is important because it is the sort of animating, vivifying force that gives life to flesh. But he also talks about another important piece that I think really characterizes the kind of tenor and tone and flow of Black Pentecostal liturgy, namely this idea of nothing music. So nothing music, he describes as this kind of connective tissue, the background sound that is heard before and after songs while people are giving weekly announcements and before the preacher tunes up to hoop and before the service ends. We could say that Black Pentecostalism is characterized by a liturgy of the sensory, the heard, felt, seen, and sounded out, enacted through the body rather than committed to the written text. And I think it's important, meaningful to note here that nothing music refers to what Crawley talks about is the sense of, you know, when a musician is playing skillfully and sort of padding and filling out the sonic register of the worship service, people will often ask, well, what is that you're playing? And they'll say, oh, nothing. Yeah. Just playing around, just noodling. But of course, that nothing is a kind of subversive descriptor. It's nothing and everything all at once. It's the kind of inchoate fabric that you can't quite put a finger on, but the thing that is absorbed through these apprenticeship practices of musicianship, through an absorbance of a musical vocabulary that can then be called upon in a way that, while people think of improvisation sometimes in a misnomer of simply playing something off the top of your head or making something up as you go along, rather, it's the active and skillful rearrangement of a vocabulary that's already been absorbed and practiced. Finally, movement three, vamp work and practice. In his essay, Black American Music and the Jazz Tradition, musician and composer Nicholas Payton makes this claim. In black music, there are no fields per se. There are territories and lineages. It is very clear who is a master drummer in the tribe and who is not. There is also a rhythmic lilt to how you phrase that is encoded in your DNA that gives a sign as to where you are from. Payton's statement underscores the significance of place and relation to how we understand the provenance and performance of black music. For the sake of my talk today, place and relation are vital elements for understanding the specific gospel musical performance we're observing. And this video that we'll watch a clip of unfolds in the context of the black ecclesial and musicological environment of Detroit, Michigan. So I'll offer by way of transparency that this clip is from the funeral of my grandfather, who was a bishop in the Church of God in Christ, the largest African-American Protestant denomination. And I chose this clip because as I was there experiencing the moment, but it wasn't until I watched the clip that I understood something about, oh wait, there's a dynamic happening here that's unfolding through the mediation of this person in the choir stand recording this extemporaneous moment. And I thought, there's something that needs to be said about that there. And so as a way of also invoking his memory in the work that I carry on, as a way of honoring lineage and ancestry and relation, I bring his name, his remembrance, into this space as a way of opening up an intervention in how Black Pentecostalism is indeed a kind of intellectual system that opens up new ways and possibilities. So, the context of this is the funeral for Bishop Isaac King Jr., January 2019, in Detroit, Michigan. The sermonic soloist is Lisa Page Brooks, who is a prominent gospel musician and singer for decades, and Kellen Brooks, who happens to be my brother, who is an accomplished organist and has played on many recordings for various folks within the Detroit gospel music tradition. And finally, this is situated in a Black Pentecostal context and the long tradition of Detroit gospel music performance. So, without further ado.
To the other location, and there was the broadcast at night, and you wanted to get to that broadcast if you didn't have a night service. All I've known this man of God to do was just worship the Lord. And I thank God, I hear so many stories I honor the Lord for my husband, Bishop Michael Brooks, tonight. He was 16 years at Pentecostal Temple Church of God in Christ. So I hear a lot of stories about the impartation and the greatness of this man here, and I thank God for that. Amen. God is amazing, isn't he? Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, just to name that song also has a lot of memory and power for me because it's what my grandma used to sing over me. So just thank you for bringing that into this space and coming as you are. As you can see from my title slide, this is a presentation around sonic medicine, healing in the midst of death and dying. And I'm really excited to be in conversation with the previous presentation. Much of the current scholarship documents musical practices, particularly around the African diaspora post-death. So we can think about New Orleans jazz festivals, funerals, and the professionalization of wailers and mourners in Afro-diasporic communities. However, I noticed that very little had been written or documented regarding music played or sung in the interspatial place between life and death, right before an individual passes on. In this presentation, it is my hope to share a small portion of my findings from, as was shared in my bio, 2 years worth of interviews with death doulas, ethnomusicologists, family members, and healthcare professionals, all of African ancestry, that has come to reveal the dynamic ways in which music and sound have had the capacity to facilitate healing, even in the midst of death and dying. I also want to take a quick moment to pause because I've really enjoyed how during the question and answer sessions, there's been an ask to talk about how did you come to this work? What is your relationship to this? And so just to share slightly about that, that connects into then my research, is that I came to this work from my experiences actually interning as a hospital chaplain here in New Haven at the Yale New Haven Hospital. And I interned from 2019 to 2020, and it actually ended in February of 2020, right before the pandemic hit, which the timing was very wild. I specifically worked in the intensive care units and the emergency room units, which meant that I interfaced a lot with death and dying. One of the most memorable experiences I had was when I was on my second ever 24-hour shift. And what's important to note at the Yale New Haven Hospital is on the weekend shifts, it's 24 hours for hospital chaplains, and there's only one hospital chaplain there on the weekends. During the week, there's a bunch of us that take over different units, but on the weekend, there's just one hospital chaplain, which meant that any call that comes in, I was responsible to answer. And so this memory of mine happened on my second ever 24-hour shift, and at 3:30 in the morning, I was woken up to a page. I was in the hospital, and it asked me to come to the second floor intensive care unit. And I, you know, waking up, walking through the hallways, and I go to the unit secretary, and I learn that there is a 35-year-old man who is the patient, and his mom had just made the decision to take him off of life support around ventilation. And so I remember going into the room and seeing this young man, and his skin was pale, and I noticed his mom in the room. And at that moment, and I think even the previous presentation that we just heard about things beyond words, I didn't have words to say in that moment. And what I became overwhelmed with was a sense of asking if I could sing. And I asked the mother, "Do you mind if I sing?" And she said, "My son loved music. Yes, please." And so I took a deep breath because I hadn't thought of what I was going to sing yet. And so I just breathed, and then I offered a song. And it was in that moment, as I sang over and into the space, that I physically experienced a change in the atmosphere. I witnessed a sense of peace and settledness in the room. I noticed tears coming down the mother's face. And I really felt like I could see divine love just embracing the body of this man before us, of this son, and noticing and seeing healing occur in this interstitial space between life and death. That encounter with mother and son was so difficult for me, but also so holy. It was an embodied expression and manifestation of the power of music. And it's what started me on this journey of thinking about the capacity that music has to heal, even in the midst of death and dying. As this conference has been showing us, presentation after presentation, the term healing can have a myriad of meanings. In a book entitled Music at the End of Life by a music thanatologist, Jennifer Hollis, healing can mean anything from the scientifically measurable cure of a physical illness to personal empowerment to learning to accept that which one cannot change. And, you know, sitting here throughout this week, I was really struck by the conversations that happened yesterday around the relational aspect of healing. And so for the purposes of my presentation and how I'm coming to understand healing, I've defined it as the experience of connecting with divine spirit, self, and or others in a way that brings about a sense of peace and settledness. You will notice there's a huge asterisk here. It is often inarticulable. So please, honestly, feel free to even like hold this very loosely because it's beyond words. The reason why I just wanted to put this up here is as I'm talking about my topic material around healing in the midst of death and dying, it's a more expansive understanding of healing that can occur even when the physical body may not be improving. And so this is just an offering to be able to sit with as we continue on. So now that you know a little bit of how I came to this work, we have a communal understanding around what healing means. I'll shift to share a little bit about the process of my studies and research. In the fall of 2019, under Yale's Divinity School and Institute of Sacred Music, I partnered with a dear colleague of mine, Jaquan Beecham, who has been here at this conference, but of course with the one time that he could not be here is in this offering, so he'll be around again. But with him and also an incredible Yale Institute of Sacred Music alum and ethnomusicologist, Dr. Alicia Lola Jones. I collaborated with them on a reading course. And in talking with Dr. Jones, Jaquan and I discovered the existence of African-American death doulas, people who often black women accompany people during the death and dying process. I had the privilege of being able to interview two African-American death doulas, and because of time, I will highlight one of my interviews with a woman by the name of the Reverend Dr. Jamie Eady, and she came to speak at an ISM colloquium, so I don't know if that's recorded, but if it is, very much invite you to watch that. My interview with the Reverend Dr. Jamie Eady expanded my research by challenging me to realize that it is important to not only document the songs and instruments used during one's final moments, but also the sounds. She challenged me to think about the language of the sonic aesthetics of death and dying. She brought attention to noticing sounds of breathing, laughing, wailing, poetry, conversations, as the songs of healing that occur alongside and in the midst of death and dying. One of the stories that she shared with me in our interview was how, in accompanying a man during his final moments, in his final months of life, he had lost the ability to swallow. He had to be nourished intravenously through fluids. In her time with this man, she came to learn that putting on the Food Network channel, for him, listening to the sounds of chefs cooking and plating and sizzling sounds of food being cooked, became a source of healing and joy for this man. Simply by Dr. Eady taking the time to slow down and be present enough to notice the impact that particular sounds had on this man, offered an ability to facilitate experiences of healing with this person. One other moment from my interview that I want to highlight is when Reverend Dr. Eady said the following: "I come alongside people in order to help them envision what their end will be." These words speak directly to the power of what it means to envision and plan for one's end. This is particularly powerful for the African-American community. As COVID-19 mortality rates have shown us, incarceration rates, and a lot of other disproportionate experiences in proximity to death and dying for African-Americans in the context of this country, a lot of times things can feel outside of our control. Things happen to us. We go to the hospital and a doctor does not believe the severity of our symptoms. We go to the grocery store and are cut in line because we are seen as invisible due to the ways that people have been trained to readily dismiss black bodies. To be able to have agency over something as significant as one's end is powerful. I want to be clear, I am not stating that we are always able to control when or how we die. Life is always unpredictable. But the act of envisioning and planning for one's end can be a very healing act. And part of this work for Dr. Reverend Eady has looked like helping people discover the sounds and songs that are healing during their end. There is so much more that I could share, so many more interviews that I would love to share. But for timing, I'm actually going to take a shift and spend the rest of our time inviting us into an embodied experience around healing. As was shared in my bio, a lot of this work spent towards creating a sonic healing album, because what happened was, in the middle of my research, the 2020 pandemic hit. And so I remember talking, right? I was collaborating with my colleague Jaquan, and we felt this sense of urgency to create something that would embody what we had discovered in our research, that would serve to tangibly offer experiences of joy and healing in the midst of unprecedented circumstances. We knew we could write a paper, we knew we could do those things, but we felt that we wanted to do something that honored the work that we had been researching and the stories we had heard. And so Jaquan and I brought in an incredible individual to collab with us named Nadelka Prescott, who has been asking incredible questions and just a beautiful presence, yes. And so the three of us then came together and reached out to folks and artists across the African diaspora, ranging from Panama to Chicago, asking if they would collaborate to create songs and soundscapes with the aim of facilitating experiences of healing. And they said yes. And so through a project and having incredible funding through the Institute of Sacred Music, we created an album that is called Gilead. The hope for this album is to be a balm, like the balm thought to exist in the hills of Gilead, referenced by the traditional African-American spiritual, There Is a Balm in Gilead. I'm gonna shift. And in your time, I would love to play every single song, but we don't have time for that. So I very much encourage you all on your own time to go through this offering. It is very much accessible and free to the public. So the website is gileadalbum.com, and it's also on SoundCloud and Bandcamp. And a lot of this hope and offering, and we're still in conversation around bringing this into spaces, into hospitals, into hospices, into nursing homes, into all these different spaces where you might not be able to physically connect, as we saw with COVID, but the power of music to actually extend and transform spaces. You will see on this site, you'll learn more about the origin of this project, the artist. I very much encourage you to see their legacy and their stories, to honor the work that they've done and where they're coming from. Also, Giving Ode, My Mom, is also on this album, because I didn't realize that the year before I was born, she actually created an Afrocentric, what did she call it? It was like a healing album in a way, but it was a cassette tape back in the day. And so we actually have sampled her on this, so really exciting. And so I want to just lift up two songs I think I have time for. Great. And so you'll notice on the page around song meanings, how we created this was we talked to artists and shared. Some of them came up with their own ideas of what they wanted to create, but for other folks, we kind of gave a prompt. And so saying, I would like if we could create something around resilience, if we could create something around transition and waiting, thinking about people in a waiting room or getting test results back or different things like that. And people took that, the artists took that and ran with it. So I'm going to highlight one of the songs that is called Ave Noir, and this was actually from an Institute of Sacred Music, a vocal student named Deborah Stevens. And you can see here, the title Ave Noir comes from the Dictionary of Obscure Sorrows. It means the desire to see memories in advance, which is what Deborah believes happens before death. We're finally able to see our lives from end to beginning and witness the story we've been telling our entire lives. Something to note on here is that every single sound that you hear is Deborah. She has a nearly 4.5 octave range, and she recorded all six voice parts herself using a multi-track software to achieve a sonic experience that speaks to the mystery surrounding one's final moments on this earth.
Oh,
just going to give a moment to settle in that. We have time for maybe one or two more. Oh, great. So I'm going to give one more that's also without words, something, again, right, talking about healing as inarticulable. We were able to collaborate with the Juju Exchange, which I very much invite you to look them up. Julian Reed, who is a dear friend of mine, and also, yeah, I think alum of Yale and Emory Divinity School. He works with a band, and so as I shared, one of the prompts we had asked was around transitioning and waiting. With Deborah's piece, she had had experiences around death and dying with family and thinking about that, and she just completely composed that out of her own experience and ran with what was already inside of her. And so this is an example, transitioning and waiting. Again, that's without words, but yeah, the interpretation of that and an offering of healing for folks. One, it is called Flow by an actually local New Haven artist named Ro Godwin. And one thing I want to note, talking about bringing in nature, the sounds of found landscapes, is on Easter of 2021, Jaquan and I actually drove from New Haven, Connecticut to Rhode Island to record the sounds of the Atlantic Ocean. And that was very particular for us because we could have used, you know, already ocean sounds and tracks, but thinking about the particular significance and meaning of the Atlantic Ocean for people of African ancestry. And so also just the fact that it coalesced with and collapsed with Easter and just all of these different things, really, really important. And so I wanted to name that the ocean sounds that you will hear on this track were recorded by Jaquan and I, and it's throughout this piece. And it's a mantra that Ro had come up thinking about difficult times and just offering a space of peace and healing. So this will be the last one we listen to. Thank you.
should I be to mitigate the fear that lives within me? What should I do if I believe everything I need feels like water to me? Everything I need is on its way to me.
Thanks, Nia, for this fascinating and mind-blowing presentation. And we have plenty of time for questions, so go ahead.
Thank you so much for this incredibly moving, for these incredibly moving presentations. Can you hear me? Thank you for these incredibly moving presentations, truly beautiful. Also, just want to make sure I say thank you for bringing Deborah into this space. She's phenomenal. Thank you very much. I wanted to return to breath. Both of you mentioned breath at some point in your presentation. Is it that which we take in, such as the energies or the vibrations around us, or is it that what we exhale outward? Or is it that cyclical exchange of memory that allow us to embody the spirituality enacting the healing?
You can start.
I think I would say, in short, it's certainly the reciprocity. What we call breath is the movement itself, rather than the kind of polarities thereof. And part of what I wanted to illustrate in my talk today was the fact that there are various kinds of breath and breathing happening. That and I've written about this elsewhere, that the kind of dynamic of tuning up or hooping, as it were, in Black church traditions, is this kind of breathing system between present congregation and the person who's giving immediate voice, not singular voice, to whether the words or the intonation, as well as the musician. And then we can even think about another layer of the breath through the technologies of the Hammond organ and the Leslie speaker, and Sean Crowley, of course, is working on some beautiful stuff around the kind of being made instrument, the breathiness of the organ. So yeah, I think it's all of that reciprocity, and the fact that breath as a process, as an act, is around us all the time, and even the dead are breathing with us. So
yeah, and echoing that, thinking about breath as being in relationship, and thinking about even as we're breathing, how there's the relationship with nature as well, and thinking about that reciprocity there. And it's really interesting that you bring up breath, because when I was listening back to Deborah's piece, for the first time ever, I actually noticed that you can hear her breathing very much as another aspect of alongside her voice. And so that, again, is thinking about the sonic aesthetics around healing. And it's not just in song or voice, but also our breath. And so that idea of cyclical. So thank you so much for that question.
And if I could really, just really quickly, even thinking about this, and so my former background as a molecular biologist, I think about like respiration, and that like what we call, think of as breath in this exchange, this medium, is not simply about the audible breathing or the detected breath, but also about the kind of passage through membranes, the ionic exchange, all of these things that are like unseen and not even necessarily audible, but are real and happening. So.
Thank you so much. Those presentations were absolutely beautiful. And just like, thank you for bringing that into this space. I feel like it was, we all probably feel like that's very much needed, especially right now. One of the things that I appreciated a lot about both of the presentations is thinking about the place of women in these traditions. And when we have conversations about Africana religions in general, whether we're talking about like spirit mask, masquerades, or if we're talking about other forms of religious performance, the roles of women's voices as vocalists oftentimes become marginalized, when in fact they're a crucial part of the ceremony. And like you brought that up in terms of these death doulas who are all women that you mentioned, and in terms of Mahalia Jackson and like her voice being crucial to what is like, you know, a political performance, but also a very deeply spiritual and religious performance. And I was wondering if you could both just expand on that a little bit, and just like thinking about ways in which in your work, that's something that's like centered or mentioned, because both of you were very much talking about in terms of the voice and the power of the voice, it was always, it was women who were mentioned most.
Ooh. I think honestly what's coming up for me, so I was very intentional. Sometimes when I do this presentation, I will talk a little bit about music thanatology, because that's like the discipline that I came into, which is the work of combining music and medicine at the end of life. And so it's the work around particularly harps, and kind of a more, there's a specific vocal entry into this work that's kind of Gregorian chant, that type of tonal quality. And so when I was doing that research, but the reason why I wanted to shift away from it a little bit was because when I saw that work, it was predominantly middle-aged white women doing the work. And so wanting to bring in the voices of Black women, and realizing also the harp is not the only place and instrument that can bring healing. And so what's just honestly coming to my mind is just a lot of, for me, particularly Black women and the ways that their voices bring healing, because other voices and even other women in other spaces' voices have been lifted as well. And so just thinking about that a lot, that has informed the work that I've done, and thinking about my own experiences with my mom and my aunt, and just like personal experiences of the power of the voices of Black women. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really briefly, I'll just say that part of what I try to interrogate in my work is how the architecture of charismatic performances, particularly by the Black male religious figures that I study, is itself very much constructed by women. Like, the stage, the staging for these things does not happen without the kind of unseen labor, often relegated as not being leadership, quote unquote. So I think for me, yeah, it's important to sort of raise these elements of how these women are not just voices, but are deeply skilled practitioners who are deeply knowing, because Mahalia was doing things that King could not, and many times would not, without her doing what she does. So I try to foreground that as a way of remembering that the labor is not
is the majority of the labor is not what's seen. Mm-hmm. That's more a product of a kind of collective voicing that often just gets attributed to certain bodies and personalities.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you both for the beauty of your presentations, for really bringing us into a moment of embodied contemplation. Mm. I think that's really important in these types of spaces. I have two separate questions, one for Kyle and one for Nia. For Kyle, I'm wanting you to say more about the role of the audience in these instances of sermonic selections. Musicologist Melanie Burnham, in her article on the Black gospel tradition, notes that audiences aren't just passive or carried along, but they have an active participatory role in these spaces. And I wanted you to talk more a little bit about that. And then for Nia, I wanted you to talk more about the process of curation for this album, of putting together the prompts and finding artists and terminology, and also the care work that you and Jaquan, or practices more aptly, that you and Jaquan developed for yourselves as you went through this process.
Thank you. Yeah, so on this question of the audience, so I think of communication scholar Keith Miller, who writes about this idea of voice merging and what it means for a person speaking or singing to actually be embodying this collective voicing, such that they are the one actively speaking, but it's the words of the collective. It's the contributions of them all. And I think this happens in a lot of really beautiful ways. It's from the folks who are echoing the song in the space, the folks who are recording, even like other people recording at the same time, because there's something about how do we capture this thing here and now, and that awareness of the capture also then informs the performance. There's also the awareness that people want to see a kind of virtuosic practice. They want to take joy and delight in the ecstasy of this person does this really well. Even I think about, so, and I know this because I knew the people there, the folks who were gathered around the organ, all were other organists, all who are also steeped in this Detroit gospel music tradition. And so part of what's being expressed there is this recognition of, you know, when someone knows the vocabulary and you take delight in how they employ it skillfully, because every iteration of the song is different. It's same verses, but changing constantly. And that change is because of this audience, this collective that's gathered. So yeah, I think it's always a communal practice. The audience is singing too. The audience is playing too, because we all know the song. And right now, we're taking delight in, I can sit back and rest and receive. I can be on the other end of the breathing apparatus and dynamic. And I think that, yeah, that's a really beautiful kind of way to think about it.
Thank you for your question. Yeah, a lot of the curation, you know, as I was sharing a little bit in the presentation, there was a little bit of wrestling with, do we create a written publication, and thinking about a lot of how, just thinking about starting things, and there's wasn't archives of these stories being told, like how do we, but also wanting to push back against, does it need to be in this particular way to legitimize the value and story, like just a lot of internal wrestling. And so where Jaquan and I ended up, and then inviting Nedelka into saying, hey, can we create this album, and how can we do this in a way that also is healing, that like has ease around it as well, you know? And so figuring out the funding and different things like that. And when we saw the funding come in from the ISM and realizing, okay, we can do this, we just really reached out to our community. And so that's why you see Ro Godwin there as a friend from here at New Haven. I've known for 6-7 years. Nedelka bringing in her roots from Panama and the friendships that she had there, being able to work in that way. And then, yeah, the Juju, like, so it became a very natural, organic process. And it was also actually a lot of fun, because I've never produced an album before. I was like, who am I? But I was like going into the studio and just like had the headphones on, and I was like, yes, okay, can we do this here? Can we do that? Like, it was really great. And so it was just, again, another embodiment of healing and even creating this and feeling like, yeah, this felt right. I'm glad that I did this, and it's okay that I don't have a paper in a Google Scholar right now.
Ksenia, and I want to know what's the place of Africa or African diaspora performance and performativity in your work? Because as a person from the African diaspora, I have kind of been surprised that I have seen three presentations speaking about the Catholic Christian experience, gospel, etc. But there is no mention of the African diaspora performativity. And for me, as a person of the diaspora, I'm pardon. I'm not trying to offend anybody. I'm just like this. For me, it's like, yeah, it's you are Africans, and this is African performance. What I'm seeing. Mm-hmm. So, but I don't see any reference to it. So, but maybe you have it in your mind, and you haven't like put it on the paper, or haven't shared it with us. So. If you could amplify, thank you.
Certainly. So in the sort of larger expansion of the project I'm working on now, part of what I deal with are the particular African roots of what we call African-American preaching traditions and sacred rhetorical traditions, dealing with some of the, particularly I'm thinking of Jacob Carruthers' work around metanature and this idea that the idea of the force of our words, the sort of what Braxton Shelley gets at and calls like thing power, being related to this idea of nomo and what it means for your words to have force and a kind of incantatory presence. So all that said, yes, I absolutely agree. And in the larger...
In the presentation of Barbara, of course, you can see, he showed us a diagram about how there is an integration between the physics, the spiritual, and this is it. So if you play or you dance or you whatever you do, you know, and you are acting from that integration place, there is no separation between the music and the spirit. And you see, it's just back home. Everything is back home, so yeah.
Nia, do you have... I'll also speak to that. Thank you so much for that. And when I was creating this presentation, I had a lot of interviews, and so there was interviews from folks from the continent as well, and one person, Dr. Jean Kadula, who actually was with the ISM last year, is from Kenya, and shared her experiences. And so one, I just want to name of, yes, a completely in that time and choosing, and that could be an oversight as well, so like apologies with that. But something that actually came up that I want to name, and as you've brought this into this space, is that it's not a monolith as well. And so what I actually learned from her is her particular community in Kenya, they actually operate a lot around silence because she comes from a place in a community that's very nomadic. And so they'd move from place to place to place to place, and one of the practices that was a part of their community was when folks, particularly the elderly, would no longer be able to move anymore, they would actually leave them to rest as an opportunity to pass on and actually just like be held and embraced in the earth. And so she was talking about, right, even the cultural differences of that might seem cold-hearted to people who don't have context for that, but there's so much more behind it. And then she also named, and there are also traditions and communities that would have us singing out when folks are in their last final moment. So yes, there's so much of that in my research as well. So thank you for bringing that into that space so I could bring it in with more time.
Thanks, Nia. We have a question at the back.
In the context of men and women role in the community, the Yoruba people in Western Nigeria, Abeokuta is one of the big kingdom in Yoruba, Western Nigeria.
Could you please speak in the mic so that everybody hears in the back?
So in 50, 75 years ago, there was a king, the Alake of Abeokuta, was a supreme king. And there was a woman, Mrs. Fumelayo Kuti, who organized the women in the market in the Abeokuta market to go against the tax collector from the king of Abeokuta. And because the king and those people surrounding him, they didn't recognize the power that could be leveraged by the women against the tax collection. So in Yoruba culture, there's a gap between men and women. But in this case, Mrs. Fumilayo Okuti knew that there's a very powerful instinct within the women which they can force against the tax collection of the Alake of Abeokuta. So this case came to a head when Mrs. Kuti organized the women in the Abeokuta market to march to the palace of the king of Abeokuta. And the march, she was in front of the march. And the women marched naked, all them naked to the, and the first time in Yoruba history, Alake of Abeokuta was disposed because of that, because it never happened in Yoruba history, and it never happened since. That's the context between Martin Luther King and Mahira Jackson, because Martin Luther King had an understanding that without one, there's not the other. But the Alake of Abeokuta didn't take that into consideration, and eventually he was deposed from the throne. And like I said, in Yoruba history, it never happened before, and it has never happened again.
Thank you for your comment. Do you have any comments on that? No, okay. So let's move to the next question. Go ahead.
Hi, thank you so much for this beautiful panel. I was interested, and it really will segue beautifully into the final panel where the two, there'll be two shepherds from the spiritual Baptist tradition doing a form of adoption, which will add beautifully to this. But my question was the kind of space and role, and I believe, Nia, you began to answer this with the Kenyan example, but the space and role of silence within these, within the work that you're doing and in the work that you were speaking of, and in terms of how that operates within the idea of tracking the emotive registers of transition and of rebirth, you know, especially when we have systems where death is the portal to beginning yet again. So I was just wondering where silence operates within these.
Thank you. Okay. So thank you so much for that question. And it very much ties in, because part of the origin story of my research also was, again, right, I talked about music thanatology, and I remember basically being like, oh, I feel like harps and middle-aged white women don't have a monopoly over this, and this has been done for so long. We just don't have a name called music thanatology for it. And then I was thinking about, I spent time in 2013, I want to say, in Ghana, in Accra, Ghana, and I made a lot of friends there, people who were from Ghana, people from Nigeria, and so in reaching out to them, I got really excited, and I was like, okay, so like, tell me all about like music in the midst of death and dying. And I remember my one friend Kofi, he laughed at me, and he was like, what? And he was like, I don't know what you're talking about, that's really weird. And then he talked to his father, who was like in a leadership in a community in a particular place of Ghana, and he was like, yeah, I talked to my father, and he was just shook and like laughed and was like, no, like we don't use music in the midst of death and dying. Like there's actually like silence that allows for a space of reverence, that allows for that portal. And so that was when it was like, wow, okay. And that's what I tried to like allude to in the I think I did in my presentation, but if I didn't, I'm doing it now, of like, it is not a monolith. And so that there's like a lot of different ways to entry point into healing. And so silence very much played a role. And then I had some friends in South Africa, a friend who was an ethnomusicologist there, and he was sharing like, no, we do use music in these ways, and it actually like creates a space for the portal of entering into, you know, a different season, a different place. So very much so, I had made an assumption of like, this is clear, this is a part of our history and ancestry, and realizing there's also silence, and that's actually very much sacred in the final moments. And one other last thing I will say actually that's coming to mind is even actually having a conversation with my mom. I asked her about her experiences around death and dying, and she was talking about how she had memories of her grandmother, and there'd be like a room that she was in as she was in her final moments, and it was the room that you'd be like quiet in. And so just seeing that connection as well, of there's also that silence of like, okay, being mindful and careful around that. So thank you for asking.
Kyle?
Yeah. I'll just say really briefly that one of the things I think that strikes me about silence, particularly musically, is that even in silence, there's never quite silence. There's never nothing. So silence is not a nothing, but rather just a different kind of substance that also helps organize, you know, what we're here. I mean, I immediately think of like John Gage and like the, you know, 4 minutes, right?
Yeah.
You know, so yeah, we could talk about that more, but I do think the silence is what accents then what gets sounded out, and it's absolutely another part of that breathing apparatus.
Thank you so very much, Kyle. I think we're coming to the end of our panel today, so I very much appreciate all the fascinating presentations. Please join me in thanking them.